about what made you so determined to take on the role.
Well, there's about 75 questions in there. I'll answer the last one first. I wasn't at all determined to take on this role. In fact, when it was originally offered to me, I turned it down. In spite of being an enormous fan of Michael Moyer, the filmmaker, and really actively been pursuing trying to work with him, and even in spite of that, when I initially got offered this, because I shared what I'm sensing is a little bit of a gut reaction bias about the idea of remaking this film. Which I totally understand why people feel that way. But then when I met, I said, you know, so I turned it down, and then another actor accepted it. And I thought, man, I might have made a mistake here, because I love that actor, he's a heavyweight. And then something happened with the film that he was doing, and he fell out, and they came back to me, and I said, you know what, I've been thinking about it, and I come back and I reread the book, torturing myself, even though I knew this other dude was then had the role that I'd been offered to turn down. And I went, and I started thinking about this, and then Michael said, is there any way you could meet me in New York? Because he was in Denmark and I was in LA. I said, I'm actually in New York for the next 2 days. He said, I'm going to come on a plane tomorrow. Can you just like give me 2 hours? And I wasn't sure if I like wanted to get into it with him, you know what I mean? So I said, all right, I got 2 hours as well, because I got this other meeting. I didn't have another meeting. And then that 2 hours like went up, and he's like, you got another meeting? I was like, nah, I was just bullshitting you in case I wanted to leave early, you know? And we spent 14 hours together. And by the end of it, we realized we were both obsessed with this phenomenon of privatization of prisons, which has been happening in the US and then all over the world. It's funny, the first time I ever came across this, it was my financial advisor advocating me to invest in prison stock. And what you have to understand, it's a rigged game, because the value of those stocks raise and fall dependent upon the occupancy of the prison. But if you are then owning the prison and get to choose, decide, or at least be a deciding factor in how long those people stay in that prison, then like any commodity, it's trading at 100% of its value at all times, because it's operating at 100% of its potential at all times. Now that's all well and good if you're a business person or investor, but if you're the person who did some small thing that was like out of character and they got embroiled in that system, and all of a sudden 2 years or 8 months turns into 4 years and you come out and you're not fit for regular society anymore. So what the French government were trying to do with French Guiana prison colony was they were trying to colonize French Guiana, but to begin with they had to cut down trees, build roads, and so this prison colony was really ostensibly a labor camp to generate money. And we thought, when we made that connection, for us it was like, you know what, forget the first film, forget this predecessor, this is a real, sort of real man, really, you know, who existed, and a beloved, important piece of source material. And all of a sudden, like, all my reservations just went away, and I said, let's go make the movie we want to make, and forget, like, our predecessor, forget the bias, forget all of the inevitable comparison we're going to have to endure, and just go make a movie we want to make. So that's what we did.